By the passion of Christ, your Son, our Lord, abolish the death inherited from ancient sin by every succeeding generation. Grant that just as, being conformed to him, we have borne by the law of nature the image of the man of earth, so by the sanctification of grace may we bear the image of the man of heaven. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed by him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity. One of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured, while we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned to him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers. And he had done no wrong or spoken any falsehood. The Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils of the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many, and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letters to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he He learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guard seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper, and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter,
"You're not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I'm not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made, because it was cold, and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there, keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret, I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I'm not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled, so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him,
"If he were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
We do not have the right to execute anyone.
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own nation, the chief priest, handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king."
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
Not this one, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I'm bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And he said to them,
"Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Don't you know that I have power to release you, and I have power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in a place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
They cried out,
"Take him away. Take him away. Crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
Do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews.
Pilate answered,
What I have written, I've written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be.
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled, it says, They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
Woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
Behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I thirst.
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
It is finished.
And bowing his head, he handed over his spirit. Now since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, They will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus. And Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths, along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
This past Sunday, Palm Sunday, Matthew's Gospel reminds us that even Jesus himself asked the Father if he might make things easier for him. Father, if it is possible, take this cup away from me. How many of us today just might be asking God to take this cup from us? As the global pandemic stretches on, most of us are continuing to experience a most unusual Holy Week, huddled around computer screens and feeling very deeply the physical separation from the members of our parish family. My sisters and brothers, we need to remember that through our baptism, we have all been gathered into the one body of Christ. And even though we are separated by time and space, we remain united in faith, hope, and love. This afternoon's liturgy of the Passion of Christ really needs to be celebrated in the fullness of the Paschal mystery of Jesus. This is less a day of sadness and mourning, and much more a day of stillness and remembering, a day of seeing once again the boundless love of God expressed in the self-offering of Jesus of Nazareth. The Passion narrative of John, which was just proclaimed, is really subtly and infinitely rich with startling contrasts. In John's Passion, we move from a garden of agony to a garden of peace. In the Garden of Agony, Gethsemane, we twice encounter the majestic I Am of Jesus. In the Garden of Peace, ultimately achieved at the cross, we gaze upon a dead man who suffers no more. At the beginning of this gospel, Jesus is abandoned by his close friends and disciples, and at the end, he's lovingly buried by acquaintances and secret disciples. An innocent man is charged and condemned as a criminal by a treacherous crowd and a basically spineless judge. Throughout this passion, we face a mocked, bruised and battered, crucified, and really an unbelievably ironic king, who seems to have power over nothing, but who claims everything is being done by power from above. God in Jesus suffers the deepest humiliation, degradation, and pain that can be suffered by any human person at any level. In our response to John's Passion, may possibly be one of profound silence. Silence is such suffering, such mystery. Yet at the very same time, there's a kind of tranquility that is suffused throughout it all. As the prophet Isaiah said in our first reading, who would believe what we have heard? Jesus is humiliation is in turn betrayed, abandoned, denied, scourged, crowned with thorns, and mocked. Unjustly condemned and brutally nailed to a cross, Jesus reveals to us a God who is a king of a totally different kind of world, king of another dimension, radically unlike our own. And Jesus, the bloodied and battered king, accepts and asserts this otherworldly dignity very simply sometimes with silence, and sometimes with very sparse words that cut to the quick. Jesus does not use power to dominate anyone, but rather he uses it to identify with every human being, even and especially in his or her greatest suffering. In Jesus, you and I are confronted by an infinite love, longing for union with us, not just in good times, but also in our most wretched experiences of life, either when we are experiencing our own suffering or when you and I inflict suffering on others. The work that Jesus finishes on the cross is the work of accepting us just as we are. It is the work of staying with us, even to the point of absorbing, soaking up in his very own body all our questioning, our weakness, our hostility, our violence, and perhaps even our hatred. Absorbing all that so that from a highly mysterious cauldron of divine love, you and I might emerge transformed. Once again, Isaiah has it, by his stripes we were healed. My sisters and brothers, may Jesus, who made the unbelievable, the infinite, the unconditional love of God for you and me believable, bring us to a deeper trust in that love. And then may we, his fragile and wounded disciples, extend that very same love to others as eagerly and as graciously as we have received it. Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our Lord and God be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty.
Almighty, ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, so that your church, spread throughout the world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen. Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our Lord and God, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith. through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our Bishop Luis Rafael, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayers for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord.
Almighty, ever-living God, who make your Church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that, reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for all of our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our Lord and God may be pleased as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one Church.
Almighty, ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God first spoke, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to the covenant.
Almighty ever-living God, who bestow your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your Church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Almighty ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you, and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly care and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those in public office, that our Lord and God may direct their minds and hearts according to his will, for the true peace and freedom of all.
Almighty ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, so that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Almighty Father, that he may extend his hand in mercy to all those affected by the coronavirus pandemic.
Almighty, ever-living God, heal those who are ill, comfort those who mourn, give solace to all who are afraid and alone, and protect all those who are providing medical care. Make us instruments of your peace among our brothers and sisters. In your mercy, alleviate our fears and eliminate this scourge, so that we may come together once again to give you praise and to build your kingdom through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Almighty, ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, so that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
This is the wood of the cross, on which hung the Savior of the world.
Come, let us worship.
This is the wood of the cross, on which hung the Savior of the world. the act of venerating the cross, is the central ritual symbol of this day. And people express their honor for the cross of Jesus in a variety of ways, with a kiss, with a touch, with an embrace, or with a simple bow. For very many people, it is one of the most powerful ritual acts of the entire Triduum. Each one of us brings to the cross the brokenness, the fear, the shame, the personal struggles that live in our hearts. We are about to venerate the cross while the hymn, "Behold the Wood," is being sung. Let us do so spiritually, or if you are able, with an actual cross in your own homes. Above all, let us remember that in doing so, you and I are honoring Jesus, the one who embraces every aspect of our humanity and lovingly raises up toward our Heavenly Father.
Thank you.
according to ancient tradition. Good Friday is the one day of the year in which Mass is not celebrated. Since all of you are unable to receive the Eucharist, in an act of solidarity with your unsought Eucharistic fast, as a presider, I also will be refraining from receiving the Eucharist that was reserved from last evening's celebration of the Lord's Supper. Together, however, let us make another act of spiritual communion by praying the Anima Christi, the soul of Christ. It is a prayer dating back at least to the 14th century, and whose very brief sentences have rich associations with the Eucharist, baptism, and the wounds of Jesus' passion. The translation we will use is based on the one done by our patron, St. John Henry Newman. United in spirit, we pray. Blood of Christ, fill all my veins. Water from Christ's side, wash out my stains. Passion of Christ, my comfort be. O good Jesus, listen to me. In your wounds I fain would hide, ne'er to be parted from your side. Guard me, should the foe assail me. Call me when my life shall fail me. Bid me come to you above, with your saints, to sing your love, world without end. Amen. Almighty, ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, so that we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please bow your heads. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Amen.